She's on our team helping out with the tech and all of the background tech issues, and also kind of like our hype person, our little cheerleader in the background telling us that we're doing a good job. So that's the team that you have today to make these trainings work. So our agenda, what we are doing today is we will be talking about our introductions, the agenda, outcomes, norms. We'll take a few minutes and do a quick little connect the group for you all. Then we're diving into the meat of the training, where we will be learning about simple ideas for adding flavor to your meals. That's really what that trailer was that Chef Fez showed, designed around. Then we'll spend a little bit of time where you all will get to go into breakout rooms and talk about special diets and how you handle those, what your procedures, what your policies are. After that, we will dive into presentation techniques and assembly line best practices. We have photos galore for you all to really talk through. And then we have time for some Q&A at the very end. Quick review of our outcomes. We like to hope that by the end of this training, you have some good ideas for how you can make use of fresh produce, beans, and salad dressings to quickly enhance and improve the flavor of the meals that you are serving. Big flavor, packing a big flavor punch is what we're really looking to do here. We also would like to discover varying ways to present common entrees and evaluate which of those presentation styles might work within your operation. And then we'll also be examining some different assembly line techniques, the best practices for those, and another kind of creative ways that you can efficiently assemble your meals. And then again, we will be understanding protocols for handling the special diets. So with our training expectations, we like to hope, we suspect that most of you are probably getting pretty familiar with Zoom and virtual meetings. So really our biggest expectation is that we just want you all to participate, and we'll be asking for participation in a handful of different ways. We'll be using the chat box a lot. We're gonna try out this annotate function that we've been playing around with, where you will get to vote on certain things. And then we will also be using the breakout room. We need to be recording this video. Thank you for asking that. We'll make sure that is done and being recorded. Yes, good to go. And then we also have closed caption as a feature as well. So it's about 80% accurate, but it's on the bottom of your bar. You see a little closed caption and you can click that and it will pop up and it will try to catch what we are saying as much as is possible. So let's connect the group. So what we would like to do is we're going to use the chat box for this. And we're going to type in the question. It's also here on the screen. But what I would like to know from you all is there a vegetable that you used to not like that you enjoy now? And what made you like it? And I'll go first. My example is mushrooms. I've been the pickiest person alive when it comes to mushrooms, until I realized that it wasn't so much the flavor of mushrooms that bothered me, but it was the texture. So if you puree them or you finely chop them, I love mushrooms and I eat them all the time now, but they still have to be in that format. So go ahead and type your answers into the chat box. What veggie did you not like that you like now? And I'll answer them out. Brussels sprouts. I love Brussels sprouts. It's the way to do it. Turtle heads. Now you roast them. Eggplant, someone else's mushrooms. Used to think they were slimy. It's a texture thing. Garlic, horrible by itself, but flavor booster, totally. Roasting, I'm hearing a lot of trends here with roasting. Raw onions caramelized, oh my gosh. I love caramelized onions, I eat them in everything. I see beets in the mix. What got you to like beets? That's what I wanna know. I love beets, but it took me some time. A little honey lemon vinaigrette on beets, delightful. Roasted, one over, nice with the beets. My sister-in-law makes a beet recipe. It's like a chocolate balsamic sauce. It's not my thing, but it's the only way her husband actually eats beets, and beets with goat cheese, it's delicious as well. So excellent. So we wanted to do this, because one thing that we do whenever we go in schools and we talk to kids is that we tell them that just like their brain is learning, you know, how to read, how to do math, all of that stuff that they're learning when they're with their teachers, their tongue is also able to learn. So if maybe they didn't like something at first, there's different ways that you can prepare, you know, a vegetable and potentially get them to like it. And it's all about trying these items and not giving up. I'm still trying to like olives. I'm not there yet, but I'm getting there. And that's really all we want you all to be aware of is, as long as you keep trying your items, try them in new ways. It's amazing the flavors that you can get from it. So thank you for that. So before we dive into the video, it's just a quick little debrief. What we will be doing is, again, we want to honor and recognize that we have a lot of different people on the call today. Small school districts, large school districts, those of you who have very limited kitchens, very limited equipment, maybe even some limited skill level here and there. So we are going to show you how you can use vegetables and salad dressings in a manner that is simple, can fit within your operation and your own capacity, and be used in a small quantity while also still packing that flavor punch that is really needed in a lot of these meals. And the reason we're doing this is because we've heard this from you all, that you've been having to do all of your meals, grab and go. It's really created a lot of changes and challenges, especially with some of the from scratch meals that you were making. And because you all are just so committed to trying to feed these kids the best meals that they possibly can get, you're reaching out to us and you're like, how can we jazz up our meals? But we want to do it quickly. So this is what we've heard, and we've designed some videos for you all to show you the process from start to finish of how you can use vegetables and salad dressings to really enhance the flavor of your meals, whether it's just one case of bell peppers or 20 cases of bell peppers. There are ways that you can make it work for your operation. So I'm going to turn it over to Chef Fez. You're going to get to see our attempts at making videos in my awesome kitchen. So have fun.
Great. All right, everybody. Thank you very much. So yes, so we are going to begin by showing you how to do a lot of great sauces, purees with peppers and onions and other vegetables. But the first section, we're going to be focusing on peppers and onions because those two vegetables, they have a lot of flavor raw, but then we're going to, you know, cook them and do other things and really change their flavors. We are going to be using whole, fresh produce. And we understand that maybe not all of you are at a level, at a capacity to, maybe you don't have the kitchen, maybe you don't have the staff, the equipment, whatever that may be, we understand and we realize that, but we don't want you to miss out. So we're going to be talking about other ways, tips and tricks on how you can still do some of these great techniques, even if you don't have the equipment or the staff, and we'll go over all of that. So the first one, and here it is. I'm going to be sharing my screen real quick. And right here, what we have, Jessica is looking good. All right, so what we have here is our mise en place. And just to recap what is mise en place, everything in its place. So all of our ingredients, we did the hard work, again, with the fresh vegetables. We cut them, we sliced them. We did some émoncé on the onions, the red peppers. We just, you know, cut the sides, put them open face. The jalapenos, we're gonna be doing something with those jalapenos and some whole garlic. So look, we just took the stems off, put some whole garlic cloves in the hotel pan, and this is our mise en place. This is how we begin. We have everything ready, equipment, food, all of our dried ingredients. We're gonna keep it pretty simple, salt, pepper, and oil. But think about your themes of the day. If you're doing Italian, what herbs can you use? If you're doing Mexican or Asian, and how do we roast them? So we have all of our onions already diced, already sliced, and we're gonna go ahead and, you know, prepare them right on the same sheet pan. Notice I'm measuring my oil because we gotta measure all of our ingredients, but I have a sheet pan with paper. And what's the paper gonna do? Remember, it's gonna help the dishwasher when it comes to the cleanup. We get them out of the way. And another way you can do it, if you have a large quantity, you can use a big mixing bowl. Again, measure all your ingredients, toss them into the mixing bowl, and then transfer them into the sheet pen. We know, and I'm sure you do too, but it's worth mentioning, don't put a big pile in the middle. Always spread them out. Otherwise, we're going to have a big pile with burnt edges. So even cooking, spread them out. For the hot sauce, look, we're going to use a little more oil because we're making a sauce, but that's it. Right into the pan with salt, 4 ingredients to make a hot sauce. That's it. So all of that is going to go right into our ovens. You know your ovens best for roasting. It needs to be hot. 375, 425, you know your oven's best. And always use your timer because that's your best friend. That's not gonna allow you to forget, okay? When it goes off, you may need to give them a little turn, stir them occasionally, but look at the color. We want them to be a little browner, a little more golden brown. So go ahead and give them a little stir and we'll pop them back into the oven. Set the timer one more time. And this is what you should be looking for, a nice golden brown. The color is completely different than when we started. They were completely white, and now you have a little brownish color. The peppers, you can tell that they softened up. They're a lot easier to eat, and they're just delicious. What we're going to be doing with these peppers, we're going to show you how to, you know, you can just serve them as is. We're going to puree them. We're gonna make a sweet and tangy sweet pepper recipe. And like I said, the jalapeno sauce, all right? And we show you peppers and onions, but you can do so many more different vegetables, cauliflower, celery, Brussels sprouts, eggplant, squash, you name it. What I want you to do real quick before I move on to the second video, go into the chat box and tell me what meals or where could you see using roasted peppers and onions, for example? Just give me a few options, please. What meals could you use this item with? Chicken fajitas! That's a given, right? It's an easy giveaway. You can put them in some spaghetti sauce, stir fries, the Philly cheesesteak, oh my God. Italian sauces, there's so many. Great, thank you. Sandwiches, exactly. All right, so now let's go to the second one. And I'm gonna be showing you now how to puree them. And for this, you need machines. You need to get a machine. So we're gonna be pureeing the onions, pureeing the red peppers, and we're gonna be making that hot sauce that I was telling you about, the jalapeno sauce. For the onions, we're just gonna put them in the food processor or RoboCook. Put the lid on, and we're gonna get them going. And you saw the ingredients, salt, oil, and pepper. So we're gonna add a little more oil just to get it going so we have a nice puree and some water. Notice I'm not adding the entire quantity of water. I stop it in the middle, I scrape the sides of the bowl, and I puree it a little more because it's kind of chunky. So I want a nice sauce. So I'm gonna finish it with my oil, add some more of the water, and it's gonna really help it bind and make a delicious, good-looking puree. And look, on a sandwich, on a tortilla, before you make a wrap, so many things that you can do with this, and I'm kind of giving it away. Now, the red pepper coulis, roasted red pepper coulis. This is just a simple puree, and if you've never tried it, oh my God, you're gonna fall in love with it. So get your roasted peppers, put them in a large container, and use your blender. A little water, look, I'm starting with 2 cups of water, but I'm not gonna use all of it because peppers have a lot of water in them already. And look, 10 seconds, there's our red pepper sauce. Try that, it is amazing. And the last one, the jalapenos. We roasted them, onions, garlic, jalapenos. Again, I'm starting with 2 cups of water, but I don't think I'm gonna use all of it. So start with a little first. The oil, I will need the whole oil because the oil really gives you a nice mouthfeel. I don't want to make an oily sauce, so I'm not adding too much, okay? And add a little bit of water just to get it pureed. And once you have it going, that's it. This is my favorite sauce. If you've never made this, I highly recommend that you do that tonight or tomorrow. Get a tablespoon, try it. It's going to explode in your mouth full of flavor. Try it, please. Same thing, go into the chat box real quick and tell me, where could you see you using some of these items that I just showed you. The red pepper coulis, the jalapeno sauce, and the roasted onion puree. What can you use them in? Ooh, enchiladas, of course. A turkey wrap. I mean, I've made that puree and put it inside of my sandwiches. It is full of delicious sweet onion flavor. Ooh, French fries. Hell yeah, to dip it in the French fries. That's delicious. I like a spicy ketchup, so jalapeno and ketchup, mix them in. That's me. A breakfast burrito. Exactly. Hummus. Ooh, somebody's getting ahead of themselves. Malcolm, hummus. I think he saw our training videos already. He knows what we're going to do with it. Toss it with pasta. Quesadillas. Thank you. All right. Let's go now to one of my favorite techniques for peppers. It's called tangy peppers. And for this, we're going to be using peppers and onions. And we're going to be using these two ingredients to really kick them up a notch. Vinegar and sugar. And I'll show you how to do that in a minute. For roasting, because we need to cook them first. This is going to look familiar. So get your sugar and vinegar, mix them up, and put them to the side because we're not ready for them yet. This is what you should look, it should look familiar to you because we already did this. It's the same process if you're going to cook them in the oven. Measure your seasonings, your salt and pepper, your oil, give them a little toss, and we're going to put them in the oven to get them cooking. So before we add the vinegar and sugar, we need to get them cooking first. So spread them out evenly and pop them in the oven. Once they're ready and you see they're halfway done, now we're going to add half of our sugar and vinegar mixture to each one of them. And notice, it's not a ton. It's maybe like a cup of in each pan. So we're going to mix them in and put them back into the oven. Set our timer. And notice, the peppers have a lot of water, so they're going to release a lot of their juices. And I don't want them to be that juicy. So we're going to keep cooking to thicken them up until it's kind of like a syrup consistency. They're almost done. So again, I really want a dried product. So you see a lot of juice still. So we're gonna put it back into the oven and keep cooking them. And look, this is what it should look like. Nice and thick, you don't have a lot of liquid left. And I'm combining them, but you can totally serve them separately, onions or peppers, or combine them both. This is the final product. And again, these sweet and tangy peppers, the sugar and vinegar, man, I'm gonna trademark this recipe, I think, and start selling it because everybody that I share this with, they love it. It is the best condiment ever. So you know what to do next. Go into the chat box and tell me, what would you, ooh, Philly cheesesteak, you know it. What other items could you put that in? And Allison, she wants that enough. I think somebody's going to be making tangy peppers tonight. What other items could you see yourself using this? In an omelet, on a pizza, of course. I eat that every day in my scrambled eggs. On a pita with falafel. Yes, exactly. Pizza. Okay, great. Rice bowl, tamales. Woohoo! Okay. Moving on, let's go now. Kind of like the same concept. We are using sugar and vinegar, a little sugar, not a ton, but sugar, vinegar, and salt to really transform our vegetables. So now let's take a look. We're going to be doing the same, but without cooking. So we have our sliced red onions. We have half moons of cucumbers. And we have some cucumbers that we're going to be making into spears. For that, we're gonna be using one of my favorite machines, the sectionizer. If you don't got one of these guys, I highly recommend you buy one. They're $250 maybe, but look, they're so fast. You do a little cutting beforehand and then you put them, pull the lever, and in a few seconds you have even, same size, uniform, beautiful pickle cucumber spears. And what we're gonna do is just put them into a hotel pan. We already have our vinegar mixture, and I don't know if I said, but we're going to be sharing all of these recipes. We put our vinegar mixture, we make sure that everything's touching that mixture, we push them down a little bit, and that's it. We're going to allow them to macerate for about 30 minutes at least. The red onions, same thing. We're going to measure our pickling juice. I'm sorry, I'm saying pickling, but you're not pickling. It's kind of like preserving it, but we're not canning, preserving. We're enhancing our vegetables. Toss those onions with our juice, our vinegar. 30 minutes works. 2 hours or overnight is even better. The next day, drain the juice and try that. They're going to be crunchy, full of flavor, and nothing like they tasted when they were in their raw state. So real quick, a few people tell me, what could you use the onions and the cucumbers that I just showed you? What could you use them in? Barbecue sandwich on some salads. Those pickled spears with a burger top as a burger topping. Yeah, burgers, sandwiches, wraps, cucumbers. Ooh, cucumber salad. Look at that. A pulled pork sandwich. That would be delicious. So try it. It is amazing. A potato salad, Laura. Thank you. It is amazing what the vinegar can do to transform those flavors. All right, moving on. So now what we're going to be doing is, I think somebody, Malcolm, you know what we're going to be showing you now. But so now what we're going to show you is what to do with our favorite vegetable that is packed full of protein, beans. We're going to be using garbanzos for this. And we have our mise en place. And these two items should look familiar, the red pepper, and the brown, the sweet onion puree. And we're going to be making two different variations. How do we make our hummus? We put our garbanzos, our lemon juice, some of the oil, and we're going to stop it and put our spices. You will notice it calls usually for tahini, which is a sesame paste. It's super expensive, and we're not adding any of it because it doesn't need it. You can, if you have it and can afford it, add the tahini, but we're not adding it because we're keeping it affordable, if you will. And that's it. You got a delicious hummus. Look at the consistency. It's just pureed beans with some flavoring. From this, we're going to take half of it, and we're going to add some of that red pepper coulis that we did. And now we have a delicious red pepper hummus. And if you notice, the consistency may be a little loose, but you can use it as a sauce at that point. The other half, we're going to use our sweet onion puree and just mix that in. And we have a red sweet onion hummus and a red pepper hummus. Now, depending on how thick you want them, you can add more lemon juice or a little less. Play with that. If you want to add the natty, because you don't, if you don't have the tahini that I was mentioning, you can add peanut butter, sunflower, or any other kind of butter to complement it, or not. You can completely leave it out. And one thing that I just want to show you, when we were making these videos, we had all this food. We made some dinner with it. We cooked a piece of fish. We served it with the warm hummus. Well, I said warm. Yes, we heated it up. And then we ate some of those vegetables. It was amazing. I've never tried a warm hummus, but that was so good. So, you know the question, what do you see yourself using those two products that I showed you? What do you see yourself using them? Chicken shawarma, kind of like what we get at Jerusalem's. A great dip for vegetables, of course. A lot of wraps. Falafel with tzatziki, you know it. A side dish with curry, yep. So again, we're just giving you some ideas, and hopefully you can, because I'm seeing curry. So already the wheels are turning. You're getting other ideas on what to do with a plain hummus. How can we bring it to the next level? A sauce for fish, now that you suggested that. I'm telling you, I've never ate warm hummus. I was like, what, warm hummus? But then with the fish and the vegetables, it was like we went to a restaurant, and it was at Jessica's house. So she cooks like a restaurant. All right, moving on. We are going to show you now a bean salad. And we've been showing you in school sea salad for about 7 to 8 years. We've been making it a lot. It's one of my favorites. It's got two beans, anasazi and pintos, but you can really use any kind of bean you want. You can use canned beans, or if you got the time and the ability, you can cook your own. But a quick trip or a trick is get your liquids, mix them in, and then you have all your dry spices so that they don't become clumps in your salad. We're going to combine them with the liquid ingredients to kind of make a paste so that when we mix it with the beans, we're going to be spreading the flavor evenly into every single bean versus a bunch of different clumps, because that's not good. So try that out. It's really great. And look how easily it spreads in your beans. Make sure you use your spatula because you don't want that money right there. Don't leave anything behind. And if you make this the night before and you let those spices and citrus penetrate the beans, oh my gosh, it's the best. These are the peppers. You saw us cooking and we just chopped them up and we got roasted peppers. We need something fresh. So we added tomatoes, fresh tomatoes. And the last thing we're going to add is cilantro, because that's just going to brighten it up. Raw, delicious. We have a, look at that color. And again, just mix it in and that's it. Any bean will work. You can substitute for garbanzos, or maybe even if you have a lentil, the hummus, you can make them with lentils too. But this is another way versus just serving refried beans or whole beans. Hey, why don't we serve beans cold? Nothing wrong with that, okay? This can be a side or a whole entree because it's full of protein. So you know what to do now. Go into your chat box and tell me, where could you serve this in? Some delicious bean salad. And you know, we're in Colorado, we grow a lot of beans. In tacos, side dish for fish tacos. Veg component for chicken wings, there you go. Use it in a wrap as a side dish on a Mexican dish. Correctly, beautiful. Oh, and you can put corn in the bean salad. So yeah, let's talk about that real quick before I move on. So imagine if we added corn. It's a totally different color that we don't have. So what would corn do? Just make it even better, more of a rainbow. So again, we're just giving you basic ideas. Go with it. Go crazy, crazy. Get creative with them. Now let's go to number 7. Now we're going to be getting into some ranch dressing. And the reason why we want to show you this, and I know a lot of you have maybe done it or you already know how to do it, but you don't want to do your dressings right now because you don't have time to cop. And that it takes a lot of time. We hear a lot from a lot of the schools that you miss giving your students your fresh items. So we're gonna still suggest that you make your fresh dressings, but instead of copying them and sending them individually, we're gonna give you some ideas on how to use your dressings in other applications versus just the salad, okay? So as we know, it calls for mayo, and we add that first because it's safer, it's less messy. And then we add the buttermilk. We're gonna be using our hands for this, no machine. So we have all of our mise en place, all the dried ingredients, and we did chop some parsley. If you have the cutting board and the knife and the time, you can chop some parsley, but if not, we're gonna use some dried parsley instead. So notice, nothing to chop, just measure, mix, and you are done. You got ranch dressing in a few minutes, okay? From here, we're gonna put it into a squeeze bottle and we are finished. Now, if you do have a machine, go ahead and use your machine and notice we're gonna be using some fresh parsley, but here, no chopping. Why? Because the machine is gonna do it for us. So go ahead and make sure you wash it and then just throw it all in without any chopping required. Make sure you do your vroom, vroom, vroom. It's very quick. And once you have it, we're going to add a little variation. Chipotles in adobo. They come in a can. They're super spicy and they give a lot of flavor. And we're going to just puree them a little more. And again, within a few minutes, we have a chipotle ranch dressing, okay? Turn it, show it, nice and smoky, you know it. So my question to you is, if you don't have the time to make those little cups, 500 a day, what other applications can you use your ranch dressing besides salad to dress a salad? So what else can you use? A slaw, that you're getting me, Allison, Melissa, in wraps, of course. How about a potato salad? Nuggets, fries, you can use it as a dipper on a burger. Carrie Hicks, you win the prize. You say to marinate. That's what I wanted you to show. If you cook raw chicken, like the drumsticks, marinate it in some ranch and then cook it in the oven. Ranch cooked chicken, it is like to lick your fingers. Chicken salad on a sandwich. There you go. I need VitaVision. What's a VitaVision? Oh, a Vitamix, like a blender? Yeah, you might need a blender for that. The acidity will break down the chicken for the dishes. Okay. So the point is, you can use your dressings for so many other applications besides the dressing the salads, okay? Will the mayo break in vitamins? I don't think so. Oh, you want a bite? Okay. All right, great. Perfect. So should we go into the last one? This is the last video that we have, and it is a vinaigrette as well. It's an Italian vinaigrette, but we just want to show you how easy it is to make a vinaigrette, and somebody else is talking that is not supposed to. and we combine the oil, all of the spices. This one calls for a little bit of water to cut the acidity of the vinegar, and we put all of the spices right in, and we broom, 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 okay, with your immersion blender. And that's it. That's how easy you can make your dressing. Just make sure you have a large enough container so it doesn't go all over the place and you keep everything clean. And again, once you make this dressing and you're not able to ship it in your salad, could you see yourself using it as a marinade on your vegetables, on your meats? I'm gonna let you in on a little secret. If you marinate cauliflower, squash, broccoli, okra, any vegetable, and then you roast it with that vinaigrette, even potatoes, we've done fingerling potatoes in this vinaigrette, you are going to love your veggies even more, okay? So let me just make sure. And yeah, you can use them for any marinades, you can use them for a pasta salad, so many things that you can use it in. All right. So moving on, some quick tips. If you find yourself in your walking and you're noticing that some of your vegetables are kind of getting wrinkly and they're kind of going dead, before they go die, go ahead and roast them up and you're going to extend the shelf life. If you have a lot of pans into your oven, it's going to take a little longer. So make sure that you work that into your day. And yeah, you can use your roasted vegetables in so many different applications, from burritos to entrees to salads. The sweet and tangy, again, you can cook them or you can do the raw cold method. All right, both add a lot of flavor to your vegetables. And again, I show you onions and cucumbers, cauliflower, celery. You can do so many vegetables with that. And depending on what you're doing, think of what you're serving on that day as well, okay? Burgers, you can do the spears, etc. For your purees and your hummus and dressings, for the most part, you do need a machine. So it's a great idea to invest in one. Instead of cupping your dressings, use them as a marinade to marinate your proteins. Or once you have an entree, you can drizzle some of those sauces right on top of it so you don't have to cup it. And for the hummus, depending on how thick it is, you can use it as a dip or thin it out and use it as a sauce. For your beans, we live in Colorado and we grow so many different types of beans. use change your beans monthly, you know. The spices, again, somebody said corn, add some corn, some green onions, add some green onions, chives, whatever you may have. You rule the world. And again, you can serve it as a side dish or as an entree by itself. A lot of possibilities. And really, this is all about making it work for you, okay? If you don't have the equipment, if you don't have time to cut because, you know, you're the only one. It's only a kitchen of one person. That's okay. You can still do some of those tips and tricks that we're showing you. They sell cut produce. Just keep an eye on the cost because it's more expensive. Or they sell frozen vegetables already cut. If you're going to be roasting them, you may need a higher temperature because you're putting frozen vegetables into the oven. And again, some of them come pre-seasoned. So just keep an eye on those seasonings so they don't compete with your meals. There's a lot of canned products that are really great, like those roasted peppers, canned roasted peppers, and then you puree them. Just make sure that the label is clean, not a lot of sodium, and you're good, okay? Beets, beans, tomatoes, there's a ton of canned products that are really good. And your spices, your herbs, when you buy them, make sure that you label them because they're good for about a year. And there's this hummus mix that you can just add water. Sure, why not? And you're done. So use the things that are out there for your advantage. And again, make it work for you. If you don't have time, we're not telling you to go prep 20 cases of peppers a day or a week. No, whatever you do, if you are able to serve at least an eighth of a cup, it will count as your meal component for that day. Okay, so don't think that you have to make huge quantities all the time. And, you know, get creative, play with your spices and your flavors. So if today is Mexican, I'm thinking chili powder and some lime juice at the end. Or if we're Asian, you know, day, we can maybe add a little soy sauce and some ginger powder. Whatever the day is, make sure that it goes with that theme, okay? And all right, what we're gonna be doing right now is we're gonna be going into some breakout rooms. We're gonna put you into different breakout rooms. You're gonna be in a smaller group, and there's gonna be a person from the CDE in each one, and they can lead the discussion. And here's what I want you to talk. We're only gonna be doing this for less than 10 minutes. Special diets. How do you accommodate special diets in your site? And what is your process? And most importantly, if you have any cool recipes, share them with us because we love to know. Everybody wants to know if you have any cool recipes for a special diet. It's a great thing to share. So hold on tight. You don't have to do anything. You're going to get transferred. And when we come back, somebody's going to have to share. And your CDE person can share with you. They can be your presenter. But just have something to talk about and present when we come back, okay? And get ready to get moved, and we'll be going here in a minute.
All right, it's working.
Okay, I'm going into room 5. Bye.
Bye, Faz. Okay, so you all get to stay in the main room. Wanted to make sure that those who need a closed caption still had that available to them. So Amber's in this room with me. She's going to help take notes. And this is y'all's time to start talking. I'd like to hear from you all. How are you all accommodating special diets? What is your process for handling special diets? And you can chat in the chat box. You can unmute now. Now's the time when we can hear your voices. Let's go. We've got about 5 minutes.
Hello, my name is Malcolm. I'm from Creed Tools. The way I have a student, well, several students that are dairy-free, and, you know, when we do like a pizza day or nacho day, it's really hard on them. And so I have, I've tried using like the vegan cheese. It doesn't melt at all for pizzas. And so I made up my own, basically like a cheese sauce that I put on the pizza crust and everything. And the kids, the ones that are dairy-free seem to love it. And the ones that aren't are seem like they're a little jealous because they think they're getting that the other kids are getting a nacho pizza. So that's one way that I've been working around kids having special diets.
So question for you, Malcolm, what is your secret ingredient in your cheese, your vegan cheese sauce? If you're willing to share.
The nutritional yeast.
Ah, yes, that's great cheesy flavor right there. Nice, yes. Well done. Who else wants to share? I can call people out, but I'll let y'all speak up yourselves before I start voluntolding. Anyone? All right, Mary, I'm calling you out. You're the first person I see on my screen. So how are you, what is your process for handling special diets? What are you all doing?
Well, normally we have a group, a meeting with the parents, with the health professional. We make sure that it's documented with the doctor. We all sit down as a group and kind of decide. We want the parent to feel good about what the child is eating. And we have found that getting them involved helps to do that. We let them know what we can do and what we, you know, cannot do or have a problem doing. And we just try to come up with what's the best for the child. You know, we can't do everything, but we can do our best to try to figure out what that child can eat. And we don't want to discourage them from coming, but we want to be honest and tell them what we can and can't do.
I was muted. Thank you, Mary, for that. Julie, apparently you were trying to chat as well. So would you like to share what you do?
Sure. I don't know where I went. I'm having troubles with my technology over here, but I have some dairy-free children as well, and they love my homemade rolls. So I just adapted it to where I don't use the milk anymore and just use water, and they turn out just the same. So
awesome. Probably a little cheaper as well, not using
Milk. That's like about it for me, really.
A nice little random benefit there from that. We have 50 more seconds, 45. Does anyone else want to quickly share how they have adapted for special diets? Multiple screens up. That's why I look like I look sideways right here. I'm like, is Sandy on the line? Because I'm going to call you out if you have like 20 seconds to share. Nada.
Mine is a lot like Mary's.
Okay.
We definitely have an open conversation with the parents and our school nurse and try to find a happy medium.
I hear you on that. And then I'm also seeing a question from Stephanie. So we are going to be closing the breakout rooms. Stephanie, let's keep chatting about that, because a child that can have no egg at all, ooh, that is pretty hard, especially if you're using a lot of some processed items and stuff. So we'll put that question out to the group and see what options and ideas some people have as well. So we're gonna close our breakout rooms. We actually have 60 seconds. So does anybody have any suggestions for Stephanie? Egg, protein, like tofu is kind of tough. It's kind of where my mind goes, but not too common.
The problem I see is that buying a lot of extra things like gluten-free bread is very expensive. And so you buy all of these extra things and then either the child doesn't come in or it spoils. So that's why we try to sit down with the parents ahead of time and say, okay, this is, you know, here's our menu and try to figure it out. Because you can't just go and buy all these expensive things and then the child not eat or.
Yep. And I think we are all coming back together into our main room. Is that correct? Yeah, I see everybody. Okay. Welcome back. So here's what we are going to do. I am going to put one question that our group had into the chat. So if anybody has any suggestions for Stephanie, they have a child who is unable to have any egg. So it makes it pretty challenging, especially if you're buying processed items, to work around that because egg isn't a lot. So we'd love to hear any suggestions from people. And otherwise, in my group, it was really meeting with the parents, being realistic about what you can offer and what those expectations are, and really having to balance the cost of having some of these gluten-free products in your kitchen with the reality of how frequently this child might actually be eating as well. So I'd say the key is communication, always number one, and then also being creative. Malcolm, he uses nutritional yeast, which gives you a nice kind of cheesy flavor to be able to make a cheese sauce that's cheese-free for his students that can't have any dairy. So I will put Malcolm on the spot for future contact if anyone's like, whoa, I would love that recipe. So I would love to hear, I'm gonna call out rooms, a representative to give me a quick debrief from room number one. So who was in room one and who would like to share?
I can share on behalf of,
thank you.
Sorry, I'm hearing an echo. I can share on behalf of room one. So it sounded like a couple people are doing in-person meals and then some are doing grab and go. For the grab and go meals, they haven't had any special diet requests, but for the in-person meals, they've met lactose intolerance by providing a soy milk. And then there have been a couple gluten-free kids and they have a baker, they bake their own products on site. So they're able to substitute gluten-free flours.
Thank you for that. Let's hear from room two, representative.
That's me. So I had group two, we talked through just like making sure to have quick swaps available at all times. But another thing that we brought up was just having that allergen-free option as a standard. So for example, like if you make a, Harry had a great vegan ranch recipe, just making the vegan ranch the standard so you don't have to constantly remember if that one has egg in it. And then it's just available at all times. And we also talked about processes, getting special dietary needs done first to avoid cross-contact. And I have some egg ideas if you wanna reach out to me about those, or I can put it in the chat, whichever you prefer.
That'd be great. Definitely put them in the chat, Allison. And then also Stephanie, feel free to reach out to her about that as well.
Yeah.
That's a great idea to just make the vegan or the dairy-free item the standard. I love that. All right, room three, tell me, give me your representative and what did y'all come up with?
Yes, I was with room three and pretty much really similar to what everyone else is doing as far as meeting with the parents and then going through and on a monthly basis, that seemed to work, that just circling what days the student plans to eat with the district and then letting everyone in the kitchen or the kitchen manager know. It's not always as smooth now with COVID and we didn't really have any examples of grab and go, but if anyone has any of those, I think that we would all appreciate them shared into the chat, some ideas.
Thank you for that. And yes, COVID, we've been told to make it, say it nicely, that it keeps presenting challenges when all we want to say is that it just sucks. So we're all figuring it out. All right, room four, give me the debrief. What did you all come up with?
Hi, That might have been us. I don't remember if we were four or five, but I'll go ahead. No one in our group had any special dietary needs that they've had to accommodate this school year, which is probably nice for them, one less thing to do. But we did talk about kind of the importance of making sure that you're communicating with the household, just to make sure that there are no misunderstandings and everything is going as smoothly as possible. And then also with like meal deliveries or grab and go, you might have to train some other staff who typically don't serve meals or aren't involved with the meal process, like a driver or something like that, on the importance of accommodating those special dietary needs and some of those processes.
That's a great tip, bringing up the drivers as well. And again, I think I'm hearing a theme here about communication and making sure everybody in the chain, from delivery driver to the people who are getting the meals, have that communication in place. And the final room, room five. I'm calling out Chef Fez because I know he was in that room.
Yeah, so we didn't have a conversation because they were not able to speak. So we communicated through the chat. But so one of them said that they only have one kid that is allergic to peanuts, and it's just that one person in the kitchen. So for that person, it's really easy because she's the one ordering everything. So she makes sure that she's a peanut-free kitchen. So that makes it easy. And that's only one student. So it's really easy to control. And then somebody else mentioned that they only have also one student that is vegetarian and gluten-free. And what they do, they found a purveyor that sells those items, vegetarian items and gluten-free breads. And what they do is that they make sure that when they serve those items, they match what the other students are eating so that they don't seem like they're getting a special, different kind of a meal. And lastly, they mentioned that it's always important to have a doctor's note so that you can set up special meals accordingly. And that's what we discussed through the chat.
Awesome. Thank you all so much. I know one thing that I've seen when I've gone into schools is that it's usually like in a separate wall somewhere, usually like in the office or kind of hidden because you don't want all the kids knowing, but they will have a photo of the child and their allergens. And that's usually really useful for when the kids are coming through the line, you know, the people who are serving can see and be like, oh, that's, you know, that's that kid. I mean, you don't call them out and it can't be observable for anyone else to see because it is a medical condition. You have to be careful there. But that's one way to be able to, you know, link the actual name with the face, which is something that I know I need my own self. So thank you all for that quick little debrief. And now we're moving into the third part of our training, which is all about meal presentation techniques. And we've got tons of photos for you all. Basically what we did is there is a Facebook group called The Tips for School Meals That Rock. And if you do not know about this and you happen to have a Facebook account, I highly recommend you get on it because it's a nationwide group of school food professionals. They have photos, tips, people are asking questions. It's really a good group just to be able to be aware of all the other challenges that everyone else is dealing with and the creative ways they figured it out. So what we've done is we've pulled photos for how people are presenting their meals. And we're going to be using these photos to see how the meals have been presented, ways that they could be improved, and to maybe get some ideas for your own operation and how you're doing your grab-and-go meals. Quick disclaimer, we are not using these following photos to make judgmental comments about any of these meals. We want to acknowledge and recognize the fact that in many cases, maybe for some of these meals, they were literally dealing with what they were able to get in the door, especially when COVID was at its peak. I mean, it's back at its peak now, but all the distribution channels, we were having challenges getting food in the door to serve these meals. So there are some meals that maybe look a little iffy. We're not here to make comments about those because we don't understand their story and why that had to happen. We're just using this next section to be able to learn from others, reinforce our best practices, and then hopefully come away with some cool ideas. So what we will be doing is we're going to be using an annotate function for this. And I'm going to have you all practice first so that we know what we're doing, because this is new for us. And this will require your engagement. So if you are looking, it's either at the top of your screen where you have the mute, the stop video, or it's at the bottom. You go all the way over to the right and you see a little pencil with annotate. And when you click that, you're going to see it's about four or five in from the left, and it's called stamp. And you see hearts, you can choose X's. So I want you to find that, and I want you to start clicking on the screen. And I can see this get full, and I can see Allison, Fernando's doing this. This screen should become full as you all start figuring out how to do the annotate function. So find that bar, choose the stamps, and I'll give you all a minute. Again, it's about four over, four or five, maybe mouse, text, draw, stamp. So you're looking for the bar for your Zoom. You have a mute, stop video, those options. You keep kind of looking to the right and you will see annotate with a little pencil. And when you click that, another box pops up that has all of these different options for you. Wow, people are getting crazy. This is awesome. I see a heart made out of hearts. All right. That's cool. So, Sherry, you should have one, Sherry, on your screen. Like, little pencil. I have reactions. That works. Oh, no, not your reactions. Seems like some people are finding it. It might also be, if it's not showing up on that full bar, you might have to click the three little dots on that Zoom bar, and then it will pull it down as well, and you'll see annotate.
For me, I'll go for one more option.
What was that, Fez?
For me, it's under view options.
So yeah, view options or the three little dots that say more. And sometimes this Zoom, they kind of move the bar. Yeah, view options at top, annotate, stamp. It looks like Helen found it. Okay. I think we're getting it. So here's what we're going to do. You're going to see the power that I have is I can clear all of the drawings right away. So we will be doing something like this as we move into this next section. And the key is we will be using the stamp, okay? So are we ready? And if you're still having a hard time finding it, you can also use the chat box and type in which one you like as we go. And we'll show you how this goes. All right, you all, I'm gonna make you stop because you're having fun. This is great. This is exactly what I wanted to see happen. All right, clearing all the drawings. No more, stop. Y'all are getting crazy. All right, Tanya. All right, we're moving on to the next slide. Oh, I need to stop annotating as well because I can't move. Okay, so here's the way this is going to work is we are, in a second, I'm gonna have you all vote on out of these six meals, put your stamp on the one that you find the most eye appealing. So take a second, look through all of the photos, and I want to see your stamp on the one that you find to be the most eye appealing. And I'll give you all a minute. We'll start seeing this all pop in. It's looking like number two is getting some wins. Number one, four, five, even three. Awesome. Okay, so what I would like to know, why did you choose them? So I'd like you to put the number that you chose into the chat box. For example, I chose number one, and I liked number one because it looks like a restaurant meal to me, something I would get when I order something to go. So someone says, Victoria, she likes number two because it's colorful. I agree. I think it's the best looking one, someone's saying privately to me. The colors, number five is very colorful. Number four, it looks hearty with the fruits and the vegetables, the way it's laid out. I like the name on it. You can see everything in it. Number five is the best photographed. I agree. It's funny how that perspective makes the picture look better as well. The veggie smiley faces. You know what, Tanya, who said that? The veggie smiley faces. Aaron, I didn't even notice that, but they are smiley faces. That's so awesome with the cucumbers and the bell pepper. All right, so what I would like to call out with these, I like that somebody did mention number five, because with number five, it's a packaged sandwich that they are getting. It looks like it already came in the box. It's a pre-made item, but it's still colorful. And it's because they're using that broccoli and the carrots in there, and they have that apple in there as well. It's just, even though it's a very, very simple meal, they still made that one look beautiful to me. Now, what I want to ask you about number five is, how could you take number five to the next level? How could you add more flavor to that meal, maybe with those vegetables, and just put that into the chat box, what those ideas might be? Maybe we gave you some earlier. Use the vinaigrette, a side of sauce, some hummus, the chipotle ranch. I love it. I was thinking maybe you could roast the broccoli a little bit. Using the hummus, I love it. People are doing great. And then let's talk about number six. It needs a cookie. I'm always down for cookies, but let's, you know, no more than once a week. So if I'm looking at number six, because that one did not get any votes, what could we do to number six to make it stand out? Mary's correct. It needs some color. So how could I change that up versus the celery and canned pineapple? Add in color, add some red. I love this. So we see it happening on number two, where they mix the blueberries and the oranges. Number five, where they mix the broccoli and the carrots. It's so simple, just to add in a little extra vegetable to get that color in there. Cherry tomatoes would be very easy with that celery. And I bet at that point it would pop. And that's all it really needs. Think about adding some roasted red pepper sauce into that sandwich and just really make the flavor go to another level. So well done. We're gonna move to our next slide and we get to vote again. And here, we're gonna be looking at salads. And I had a hard time choosing salads because there are thousands of gorgeous salads out there. So same process, find your stamp, choose your favorite. Which one do you like the most? Which one is the most eye appealing? See them all pop in. Number one's getting some votes. Got a couple on number eight. Number two's gotten one. Number four, six. People are drawing arrows on number one. I love it. So tell me, why is number one speaking to you all? Ah, and some of them, some ace thinks they have too much going on. Interesting. There is beauty in simplicity as well. Number one is colorful, I do agree. I like the fact that in number one, that is a reimbursable meal minus the milk. They have their strawberries and their grapes right here. They've got their croutons for the grain, their meat alternate with the cheese and the ham and all their veggies. And I think it's that works right there, especially if you're doing grab and go and you need to maybe minimize the number of boxes that you're sending out. That right there is a great way to do it. They're also doing that in number 8, where they have their little fruit juice cup in there as well. Not sure about the grain in that one, but if you can include all of your items in one container, because that's the container you have, I think that's a great thing to do. I do want to talk about number 5, because I think number 5 has potential, but number 5 to me, something's up with it. How can we make number 5 look better? Take the apple out of the bag. If that makes sense for you, yes. It does look sloppy. I agree. It looks like it survived an earthquake. Yeah, pretty much. So, but I love the use of the radishes. Group the veggies. Laura, you are exactly right. This is something I think is very important with salads, is try to group your vegetables into little piles versus, you know, just kind of putting that haphazard mix on there. If you are, because we recognize that sometimes it's easier to compose your salad, go ahead and combine all of your veggies and then plate it up. You can do that, but toss it all together and go that route versus what looks like here, they just put the lettuce and then they just, I really don't know, like made it rain all the veggies on top of the salad. It's a little messy. So again, think about that with those presentations. And I also want to talk about number 7, because I like the fact that they rolled that turkey, but do you think that's practical? And you can type it in. It's too hard to eat. It needs to be bite-sized. Rolling turkey is time consuming. So again, you all know your limits. You know what makes sense for you, but be aware of that. I personally would dice that turkey and call it quick. One meat's rolled, rolled them both, chop them both. Malcolm, you are right, 100%. It would take a person all morning to roll that. I see rolling turkey like I do peeling kiwis. You don't need to peel your kiwis. Cut them in half and do little kiwi cups. Try to save your time. Be realistic as well as to what makes sense for your operation. Now, we are going to move to our next slide. Same thing, pasta-based meals. We've got red sauce at the top and we have kind of the white yellow sauce at the bottom. Tell me, which one is your favorite? And tell me why. Number 2 is getting a lot of votes. It's pretty simple, but it looks good. Maybe some stars on number 1 as well. Color again. I do think it looks nice. That sauce does pop. Would it be nice to maybe sprinkle a little bit of Parmesan cheese on top of that? Question with number 2. I mean, they're doing broccoli and grapes. But would it make sense to maybe switch out one of those and change up the color just a little bit more? Sauce, and so this is something, this is a great point that Harry's bringing up. I think when it comes to how you present pasta-based dishes, sauce on the side, sauce in a cup, already mixed, like what we're seeing with number 5, number 6 is mac and cheese, you would mix. It really depends on how this meal is being served. Are you packaging it up, grab and go, and then it's immediately going and getting eaten? Or is this something that's meant to be reheated later at home on another day? That will really help you make those decisions for how you should present your meals. One thing that we will talk about though is the less that you can cup your items, the more money you will save and the more time as well. So we really want you all to think long and hard about what makes sense within you and your operation and overall transport as well. Because like in number 3, you know, it makes sense to maybe have that applesauce cupped, because if they're transporting that and that's getting picked up somewhere, you don't want applesauce to maybe tilt and fall into the pasta. So it's a give and take in some situations, but do find out what makes the most sense depending on when these meals are actually being consumed. Excellent job there. I'm going to clear all drawings and we're going to move on to the next slide. So these are all Asian styled meals. They're basically a play on what looks like a sweet and sour type of chicken. Number two, this one is a meal that they are serving later. It's meant to be reheated at home. So they're not just serving frozen veggies to the kids. That's gonna be reheated at home. So let's get some votes and find out which one is your favorite on this page. I'm seeing some votes for number four. This is awesome. Tell me why. Why number four? Why number five? Why did they stand out? The colors and four. I gotta say, something about number four, like that looks like something that I would order from a Chinese or a Thai restaurant and it would show up at my door just like that. Like that's what I would get. So I think that's kind of cool. Looks more inviting. It looks like it's from a restaurant. I agree. And I like number five as well, because I like how they presented it actually, and kind of almost, it's almost like they did a waterfall effect with the chicken kind of like over the rice, and the broccoli looks like it's been steamed nicely. If it's a meal that's meant to be eaten all together, that works as well. And you don't have to separate it out, but you can, if it makes sense. You all know your kids as well. And again, presentation, especially when you're doing meals to go, is important as well. And we know that it is a challenge. All right, we're gonna move on to the next one. Again, we have tons of photos. So these are all Mexican themed meals. There's some kind of variation on like tacos, like a build your own burrito, fajita type of thing. So what is standing out? Which one is the most eye-appealing for you? Seeing some stars come in. People are choosing number three. I think number three looks nice. I like that plum. I think number one looks good as well. Number five's getting some. Nice. This one was hard. Number four looks good. I think Mexican types of meals can be a bit challenging because it's a mix between, do you have the students make it themselves? Do you go ahead and pre-make it with grab and go? I think as a whole, you have to kind of serve it almost in this decomposed type of style, but you can still make it look nice. And even number six, I think it does. It looks organized and it looks clean. Honestly, a lot of these look fine to me. As a whole, when you're doing lettuce and tomatoes and serving Mexican style meals, you're going to get that color anyways. And obviously the flavor punch is awesome as well. All right, and we're gonna move on to, I believe, our last set of photos. Chicken entrees. So these are people who are just serving kind of your standard chicken, potatoes or chicken greens and rice. Tell me which one you like the most. Number six, number two. I gotta say, I have a personal bias for number six, but maybe it's because I love mac and cheese, but I also love the blueberry and that one single strawberry in there. I mean, we know strawberries and blueberries, you know, they are a bit expensive. You don't need to do that much, just one strawberry in each one, and it just makes it pop. It looks great. Less plastic, the better. We hear you 100% on that, Harry. Again, the less that you can use your cups, the better. And Chef Ez will really talk about that a bit more. I also like number two. I mean, again, it's simple. They're probably buying frozen crinkle cut carrots and maybe even frozen broccoli, but it's all about using your colors, using your vegetables to bring these colors out. And I'm surprised that no one clicked on number one. Number one, while it's very simple and maybe not as bright as it could be, I think maybe if they were to add just some red bell peppers into that rice, that could look really nice. But it looks good. It looks like roasted chicken on the bone with like a collard green and some rice. And that's a meal that I would eat. So they all look good. And these are just presentation ideas. Again, I know one is plain, no color. But just think, if we were to add some of those pickled tangy peppers into that one, it's all you would need to make it pop. So it doesn't take much to make these meals pop. And that's really what we want you all to think about. So I'm going to move on to the next screen and we're gonna have Chef Fez take over. We are done with the annotate function, but you all love that. So we'll definitely use that one again. And I'm gonna let Fez talk about assembly lines.
All right, great. We go to a lot of kitchens and we see that a lot of you already know how to do an assembly line. But for some of you that this may be new, or maybe you're the only one in your kitchen, you're like, an assembly line? I don't know that I can benefit from that. Well, yes, you can. So let's go over the definition first. So when we're talking about an assembly line, we are meaning that one or two people or more are working in a sequential manner to get a job done, okay? And when we are talking about a sequential manner, we're talking about a sequence, a one, two, three, we have steps we must follow, okay? And as you can see in this photo, somebody is doing pretzels, the other person is doing the carrots, and somebody already did the turkey rolls or the wrap, whatever that may be. Somebody has a job. They're concentrating on that one job. They're not stepping on each other's toes, and it's very efficient, okay? We just want to point out that when you do an assembly line, it is super efficient if you do 150 at a time versus doing one, and then you do the pretzel, the carrot. Don't ever do that. Line up all of your boxes, your clamps, and fill them up, all right? Next one, please. For this assembly line, I really like it, and I hope you get you're gonna agree with me, I hope, because look at all the sandwiches that they're making. How many are they doing? I don't know, they're doing tons and tons. They're using every inch of space available, okay? Now, if for some reason you wanted to use a really nice condiment, go ahead and do it in between the lettuce and the cheese and the ham, so when you send them out for later, it doesn't make them soggy, okay? So go ahead and keep that in mind. But again, just look how efficient they are with their space. They're not, you know, wasting an inch of space right here on this table. For this assembly line, again, you gotta do a lot of prep work. And we know that as cooks, as chefs, we know there's a lot of prep before we start making our meals. But we just want to point out all of the work they did ahead of time. Number one, their carts, their speed racks. So they're making all of those items, their cut cucumbers, they have them on the top over here. And everything's ready to go before we start our assembly line. Look at all the colors. They have everything ready to go. And again, the use of the carts is one of the best things you can do to your body and be a little faster as well. We found, Jessica found this photo, again, on that Facebook group, and we really want to show it to you because this is a great tip. Somebody figure out that you could make your baby carrots with the dressing in a cup and put a lid, or your salad in a cup and you put your dressing. But what we want to point out here, look at how they manage their space. They figure out, because the lids are super tight, they can flip half of them so that you can utilize every single inch available on that sheet pan. And that's what they did. they flip half of them and the other ones are standing upright. And you figure out how many cups go in a tray and you count trays. You never count salads. You count how many trays you have so that you know how, because right now we're making hundreds of meals a day, perhaps to go. So don't ever count individual items, count sheet pans, okay? On this next one, again, maximizing space pros. You probably are doing this already. You figure it out that your cafeteria is the largest prep room that you have available. And as you can see, everybody figure it out. They put their tables down, they put their bags or boxes, whatever you're sending. And this is a great way to utilize your cafeterias. And you, I don't know if you can see that person on the top left corner, it's on the very back. They're using a cart. I don't know if she's the only one working, but if that was the only person working, I want to, yep, in the red eye, I want to use the cart because I want to be nice to my back. So utilize your equipment that you have available, okay? And you'll be very fast. For this one real quick, let's begin on the left. Instead of sending corn for one day, carrots for the other, and whatever, they figure out that corn for the whole week. So instead of cupping it, they purchase deli containers. And in the restaurants, we use them all the time. If you've never seen them, they have different sizes, 1 cup, 2 cup, and these are 4 cups, so 32 ounces. And you can do that, fill sauces, rice, whatever, chili, whatever you may need to send, if it's for more than one day, versus sending it in little cups. So those are the deli containers and they work great. Right in the middle, we like this picture because they're doing something like a buffalo chicken wrap. And they really thought of the quality of the meal, because if you wrap it up and they're not gonna eat it for 4 hours maybe, it may get soggy. So what they did, they separated everything and the tortilla, it's folded on top of the dry lettuce. So it's not gonna mix with the chicken and make it soggy. It's a great way to keep your meal as fresh and good looking as possible. And the last picture, again, kind of like the upside down cups, they're using what's available in your kitchen to make sure you work as fast as you can. These are the bread racks. And again, we're looking for space. They figure out we're gonna use the bread racks to put our sandwiches. And again, you don't count sandwiches. You figure out how many sandwiches you can put in a rack and you count racks, all right? Utilize what you already have, because unfortunately, you're not gonna get a new kitchen next year, sorry. All right, next picture. So I think Ace brought this up on the chat a little bit ago, talking about the number of cups. And this is a great point. So something to consider, okay? What makes more sense? You need to do a little math, a little cost-benefit analysis. On the left, we have one container with a lid. And inside of that container, we put a cup of lettuce, a cup of meat, a little cup of cheese, and another cup of grapes. Too many cups, if you ask me. And then you go to the right, and those containers, they tend to be a little more expensive because they have the segments, the compartments, but it's only one container and one lid, and that's all the plastic that you are using. Again, I just want to show you this because what's better to use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different plastic things versus just one clamp with a lid. Another thing to consider, you also have to pay somebody to fill the cup and the lettuce. So all the time that it takes to cut versus just putting it all into one clamp, done. I'm not here to tell you what to do, but you need to do some math and some benefit, cost-benefit analysis, and you'll figure out what's better for you. Next, please. All right, so these are the assembly line all-stars. We think they're doing some amazing work. We really like these pictures, and we wanna ask you, go into your chat box and tell me, what do you like about these photos? Both of these, we think they're doing an awesome job. If you agree with us, what do you see that they're doing right? Cups, the more cups, more waste, masked up. That's from Harry Mathis. So based on this assembly, the teamwork, it looks very efficient. It looks like they're not stepping on their toes. On the left, they got a long table out in the cafeteria that goes who knows how long. They're making as many burritos as possible. The clamps are right on the right, are beautifully organized. Exactly, they're going into each other's lid to use more space, okay? They're using the carts. It looks clean, the teamwork. I think teamwork is the big thing right here, okay? So again, hopefully you're getting some ideas on how to do it on your own, but we really like this too. All right, and this last picture real quick, let's pretend, all right? You just got hired to work in a kitchen and you are the kitchen manager and you're walking in, it's your first day, and your cooks are fast working and they're getting the Cuban sandwiches ready to go for today because that's what we're serving, Cuban sandwiches. But you come in and you notice that your three cooks are working like this. Based on what we just learned, what suggestions could you offer to make this assembly line more efficient? Again, we're not criticizing this photo, but we are using it to see if there are any opportunities that you can suggest this group to make a better assembly line. One person per job, exactly. Not everybody do the master, no, only one master person. Water bottle, oops, we have a water bottle, get it out of the way. Exactly, we need to have a water station. You know, we can't drink where we work. The social distancing, I know, but it's mostly on the efficiency. We can use the space a lot better. We can lay out our bread. Somebody does the mustard. Somebody comes with the pickles. They don't have everything ready. It doesn't look like they're ready to go. No bueno, LOL. I agree. It's no bueno at all. So I'll just say it. I say new manager with a very nice heart. Hey, girls, let's see if we can try something new. In my older job, we used to do it like, I don't know, come up with some good suggestions so that you are just trying to help them out, okay? But I think this is a great photo that we can show how to become how to make a good, efficient assembly line. And with that, I think continue rocking it and trying new things. From working in restaurants, Jessica and I, we have a long history working together. When something goes wrong, when things don't go your way, guess what? It's always like that. Even today, getting ready for this call, things did not work, but we make it work. So we just want to show you this photo because these people, instead of complaining and how we're going to get these meals out, and they think, let's get some sticks and push 10 bags at a time. Get creative, okay? Again, use what you already have and try to make the best of it, all right? And I think that's, let me see, yep. If you have any questions, this is the time, but please remember that we will be having two more trainings coming up. You will be getting an email from us to remind you, so be on the lookout for that. But also from the CDE, they're gonna send you an evaluation. So be on the lookout for that as well. And remember, we are going to be, for the next trainings, we are going to be discussing some time management techniques so that you can make some weekly production planners to set yourself up for success. So hopefully we will see you again in January, early February next year for the next training. And again, look out for that evaluation because that's how we can keep creating trainings that fit your needs. So thank you so much for your time, everybody.
Thank you. Let us know if you have any questions. We'll be on the line for a bit.
Oh yeah, this is the Q&A time. So if you have any questions, ask.
Yes, we will share all the recipes and the recording. So keep an eye out for an email Probably later this week.
Yes.
Could you get to Facebook again?
Thank you. You guys were awesome.
Thank you, Carrie Hicks. We'll see you soon.
I would love to share my slaw recipe.
Well, why don't you send it our way?
Okay. Well, you know, I'm like a, I just throw stuff together. So I'm just kidding.
Don't we all?
as chefs, yes.
I don't have
measurements, but I have ingredients.
I was going to say, be careful what you say. The CDE is on the line, so.
Oh, goodness gracious. But I follow all guidelines.
Yeah, but thank you so much for being open. And somebody said that they have pictures and they wish they could share their pictures. So
that was me.
What that mean?
Yes.
Okay, so I want to see your meal.